Hello and welcome to the online learning session ABB RoomTouch KNX alarm messages, time programs and some more functions. Yeah, Jürgen, who will present today, was very busy in the last time to test everything around the RoomTouch and to prepare our online learning sessions. So today we have another 30-minute session. I think it will be the last session for our ABB RoomTouch at the moment at least. Yeah, my name is Thorsten Reibel from the ABB Competence Center Europe Smart Buildings, and as mentioned, Jürgen will present today. As always, it will be recorded, this session, and will be as a feedback email sent to you later, both video but also the presentation. Still today, I sent you at least the PDF file of this presentation. Yeah, online learning session webinar, so we continue also in the next time with this topic, mainly because we cannot do any classroom or presence trainings in the factories at the moment or anywhere else in the world. So more content will follow. We come later to our next topics. And yeah, I would hand over now to Jürgen. He will continue.
Hello and welcome. Jürgen Schilder is speaking and I present this online learning session. Thanks, Thorsten, for your introduction. What is on the agenda? Today, I will show more functions of the ABB RoomTouch KNX. These are first the fault and alarm messages, then the time programs, and then the proximity sensor, the primary function, informating starting page, and so on. After a brief introduction to the ABB RoomTouch KNX, I come to these two main functions, alarm messages and time programs. So some words about the ABB RoomTouch KNX. In September, we launched this new ABB RoomTouch KNX panel. It is available in a so-called white and black color. It can be mounted in a portrait mode, like here, or in a landscape mode. So the ABB RoomTouch KNX is enough or offers enough functions for a room, like in a hotel room, in a residential home, or in an open office, or for example, in a meeting room. So we have different kind of control elements, like for switching, for dimming, for controlling shutter and blinds, to control also audio devices or cold scenes and room temperature control. So what is now important, that this device is now commissioned via the ETS and additional ETS DCA app. Let's have a look maybe in typical rooms, like you see here on the left side, three several units. One is used for switching the light, the other one for the aircon system, and another one for the maybe shutter or blinds control. Or here also three different maybe units for the systems. Here in the middle we have maybe up to 10, you see here 10 conventional push buttons. I'm not sure how an end user can operate this. Or I think the highlight is here on the right side, a typical meeting room with the switches for the lights. We have here remote control, maybe for the aircon system. Here a panel with different buttons to do some things or to change here the volume. Maybe this is for the projector. And here again, a remote control. And on top, you can see here a guidance how to operate all these units here. So what we can do, we can make it much more better via KNX and the ABB RoomTouch. With the ABB RoomTouch, we have all features we need in a single room. Good, the ABB RoomTouch offers now up to 30 control elements. A control element can be used for switching, dimming, control also, for example, a fan coil unit or a split unit gateway, an audio device, we can call scenes. So maximum, we have 30 of these control elements. Plus some more functions like the fault and alarm messages and the time programs we talked today. Additionally, we have logical function inside and also scene actuators. More information about the RoomTouch you can find on our training and qualification database. We have given some webinars and also online learning session about all these different topics. And on the product page, you can find more information about the device, the product manual, and the KNX ETS application, and of course, this special DCA app. You will find all this information at abb.com/KNX. Good, then let's come to the fault and alarm messages. The conditions and devices must be monitored in every kind of building. This can be, for example, an alarm relay for an air condition system, a water alarm sensor, a temperature sensor for temperature of a flow or return temperature, or for example, measure the pressure too high, too low, or this the CO2 concentration in a room is too high. And now, in the event of this failure or alarm, this must be also communicated and displayed to the end user. So we can use here our ABB Room Touch to display these different kind of alarm messages. So maximum, we can have here up to 20 different alarm messages are here possible. We have different categories. We have the so-called alarm messages, we have fault, and we have hints. So later you will see we have here different colors, like here red, this is alarm, and maybe here a little bit blue and black, this is only, for example, a hint or information. So the limit is here, maximum 20 of these alarm messages. So what can we do else? We can also store or export all these alarm messages on an SD card. So we need here SD card inside the device, and then all alarm messages can be exported or archived here on this SD card in a CSV file. Then you can remove this card and import this CSV file, for example, to Microsoft Excel. So and all these alarm messages are now handled on a separate page, the so-called alarm page. This alarm page can be also protected by PIN. That's what I show you now later. So now let's come to the commissioning of of the Room Touch, and we want to create such a typical alarm message. So at first we start, we create a project, we add here our device into the building or topology view like a typical KNX device, and then we have to click here on the so-called DCA window, not to the parameters, DCA, and in this DCA app we set all the necessary parameters. So we click here on the so-called application view. On the right side, we have the navigation view of all our pages, or for example, the rooms with the control elements, but we go on the left side to the applications. So in the applications, we have a submenu called fault and alarm messages. So click here, and then you will see on the right side all these parameters, the so-called general parameters of all fault and alarm messages, all alarm messages. So we set here all the parameters, which are quasi necessary for our alarms. So very important, the parameters appears only if you enable here the first importance parameter, use fault and alarm messages, and then you get all these parameters here. So, and then we can continue and start and add here our maximum 20 alarm messages. But let's have a look at these general parameters. So do not forget to tick the first parameter, then we enable here the alarm message window, and we get enough more parameters. One is, for example, if this alarm menu protected by a PIN, yes or no. When we say yes, and then we have to enter here the PIN code level. Maximum we can have here 3 PIN code level. So when an end user wants go into this alarm page to see, for example, the archive or delete an alarm, then he needs here the PIN with level 1. So additionally, should it be possible to export all these alarm messages? Yes. And then we can enter here a file name, like for example here alarm list or something. And then all these alarms will be exported on the SD card in the so-called CSV file. The next parameter, automatic archive at acknowledge, yes or no. So when you tick it, and then automatically the alarm is shifted here to the archive. If not, and then we can tick here, archive when the alarm is not longer active, then he will automatically archived, yes or no. So the next, we can select, for example, the sound for an alarm. We have the 3 categories. We have an alarm, we have a hint, and a fault. So when alarm happens, then maybe the sound number 1 is played. If we have a hint, then the sound number 2, and for a fault, for example, sound number 3. So we have different kind of sounds we can select here. And the sound, the volume between 0 and 100%. So some of these parameters can be also changed by the user in the alarm menu. Like for example, the alarm, hint and fault sound and the volume. This is what the end user later also can change when he has the access via his PIN code. And via KNX, we can also change the volume via KNX Telegram. Between 0 to 100% Telegram, the sound can be also here, the volume can be changed. Good, then let's create the first alarm message. So we click here on the button plus in the fault alarm message view. And then on the right side, we get here the first parameters. So let's start here, click on the button plus, and then we have here our parameters of the first alarm message. So we set all the parameters on the right side. For example, I show you the next slide, all these parameters. And then when we have set the parameters, we do like always linking the group addresses. The advantage of this DCA app is here that we have on the left side all our group objects of this selected here message number one, my first alarm. And on the right side, I have all the group addresses. And via drag and drop, I can link here the group addresses. So it's not necessary to leave the DCA app and do it like standard KNX device. You can do it here. Yeah. And you see here only the group objects of this selected message here, no more. So you're not confused about hundreds of group objects. You see only these two group objects or three, which comes here from our alarm message. Good, and at the end, download the application like always. So some more information about this alarm messages. So when you click on alarm message and press your right mouse button, then a new window pops up. Here you can copy also alarm message and paste. You can delete alarm message and you can also here rename alarm message. So also here is also possible. So then let's come to the parameter of an alarm message. At first, we can enter here the name of this alarm message. This name is only shown in the ETS DCA app. So this is not what the end user later can see. This is only for me that I can enter here, yeah, for me a useful name like Water Alarm Kitchen. So the next, I select here the type of the alarm. This can be an alarm with the highest priority. It can be a hint, yeah, only to give you information that someone happens, or also a fault message. These are the three categories of alarms we have. And the type of the alarm. So this alarm is now triggered via a 1-bit telegram with the value 1. So the value 0, nothing will happen. Only if the telegram has the value 1 alarm, and then this alarm will appear in the room touch. Or alarm message can also triggered by a 14 byte. Yeah, but what is it? I show you also in the one of the next slides. So and then we enter here the text for the alarm message. This message here will pop up in the room touch. So this is what the end user later can see when this alarm is now triggered. So it makes sense to write here a good text, like for example, water alarm the kitchen, and recommendation what the end user has to do, for example, like close valve number 7 or something. So next parameter, send 0 at acknowledge. So the message appears and the end user presses the button acknowledge, and then a telegram with the value 0 is on the bus, maybe to reset your alarm sensor or do something else. If you want, yes. And if you want to get an acoustic alarm signal, sure, we want to have it, then we tick it. If we don't tick it, then we hear nothing and only the message pops up. The time of the audio signal in minutes, for example here 1 minute, and repeat as long as it's active, yes or no. When we tick it, then the alarm message will be here repeated every 30 minutes. These are the settings we can make here for each single alarm. So then let's come to an example. Like for example here, I have an alarm called message number 1 alarm. It's from the type alarm, a 1-bit. I have entered here the kitchen, the text of the water alarm kitchen. So then I get here two group objects. One is a group object, message input, a 1-bit, and I get a second object for the acknowledge. So with this group object, I trigger now my alarm message, and with this one, the room touch can send out here acknowledge messages. So then let's start. So we link here group address to these objects. When the group address has the value 1, alarm, and then you see on the left side, this alarm message now pops here up with the type of the alarm, like here alarm, because here on the right side, I have enter selected here, you are an alarm. The color is red, but I think it depends here on my camera. That's why it looks a little bit orange, but in real, it is really red. We see here the date and timestamp and water alarm kitchen close valve number 7. So this text here, yeah, will be then here displayed. So this means exactly the text what the end user later can see. Good, this is exactly the first step when the alarm is now triggered, the pop-up and the acoustic signal is now also here, you can hear it. So the next step is to acknowledge the alarm. We have two possibilities. One is by the end user. So he presses here this button, this arrow, to acknowledge the alarm. Then what happens? At first, the group object acknowledge message one bit is sent here to the bus to acknowledge the alarm. And here the signal is this telegram is also sent with the value 0 because we have enabled here send a 0 at acknowledge, and then he will send here back this triggered alarm group address with the value 0. Good. What is also possible to acknowledge via KNX Telegram. So the end user has not to press here this arrow, this button. So we can also send the acknowledge with the value 1 to this object acknowledge message. So this is also possible. So now let's come to the next type of alarm. It is a so-called hint or information. So we have the same objects, and when this object here receives a telegram with the value 1, then here our information, which looks a little bit more in blue, will appear and gives you here the information maintenance of the filter system, like I have entered here my alarm text. And the sound is now different because I have selected here a different alarm. Or the third category is here. The type is a fault message. Fault means we get only maybe here a kind of warning. Yeah, it looks in real a little bit orange. And again here we get the information boiler temperature too low. So here we get only maybe fault message or something is wrong with our boiler. So and again the same two group objects. So now what about this 14 byte? Why we need a 14 byte object to trigger an alarm? Okay, so let's have a look at first at our group objects. So if we have one group object with 14 byte, our input, see it, we can trigger our alarm. Then we send the alarm message as 14, acknowledge at 14 byte, and again our 1 bit. So what was the practical use? So at first we link here group address and any 14 byte text which comes here to this group object, like for example hello or something else, yeah, triggers now our alarm. So it doesn't matter, it must not be a fixed text, it can send any 14 byte text. Yeah, then the alarm is now here triggered, you see alarm, because I have set your type of alarm message. And this text here, which is received on the input, will be now visible here on this alarm message. So like here, I have sent a 14 byte telegram with the data, like hello, and then hello 14 byte, and then this text hello 14 byte is displayed here. So when you send here a value with 14 byte like intrusion or panic alarm or temper or something, then this text will be displayed here. So this is also very flexible, yeah, to make here a text really dynamic visible. So next step is we press here our button to acknowledge the telegram, and then this acknowledge text we have entered here, text at acknowledge, like alarm XYZ acknowledge, is now sent out to the KNX via this object here, acknowledge message. And the acknowledge message, the 1 bit is here also to send to KNX to acknowledge here our alarm. So it's a nice feature. Let's have a practical experience. Yeah, together with our so-called KNX security module or security alarm panel. So both of the devices uses 14 byte texts. So this security module monitors our building for intrusion alarm, panic alarm, and everything else. And in case of intrusion, it triggers alarm messages, typical 1 bit, switch on the siren, and a lot of more things. But additionally, this security module is also able to send 14 byte text. So like here we have the object alarming text alarm type 14 byte. So in case of an intrusion alarm, the device sends a group telegram with this 14 byte value like intrusion or temper. So we can link a group address from here to this message input of the room touch, and then depending on the type of the alarm, he sends intrusion, yeah, or panic or temper or something else. And then this text here, which comes from a security module, this dynamic text is now displayed in the room touch. This is a very nice feature. Like here, for example, we have intrusion alarm, then the device sends 14 bytes, the word intrusion, and then you can read here intrusion. Or in case of panic alarm, then we see here panic alarm. So this is an example how to use this 14 byte text messages. So then let's go to the alarm page. So at first we have to go to the main menu. So the main menu, we have our system page, we have the timers, the alarm. So we tap here on the alarm, and then here the menu page alarm pops up. And here we see all kind of alarms which happens in the past. Like for example here, maintenance of the filter system, yeah, my hint or the boiler temperature. This was my failure message or my alarm, water alarm, kitchen. So this will be visible here. So we can also move these alarm messages into the archive. So we press and we slide this information to the left, and then on the right we get here a small blue square, and here it looks like an archive, and when we press here, then it's moved to the archive. Or if you have set a parameter, automatic archive, and then this message will be automatic shifted in the archive. If you want to go manually to the archive, you click here on this button, archive, yeah, and then we go to the next submenu, yeah, like here on the right side, we are now in the archive, and then we get here the archive of all our alarm messages. Then we have the possibility to delete here all alarm messages, delete all, you see here the rubbish bin, or you can copy all these alarm messages also to the SD card. It is maybe easier to enable this parameter, copy to SD card automatically, and then all these messages will be automatically copied to the SD card. Good, how to link the group addresses? At first we have some two group objects which belongs to the complete alarm message handling. One is for the sound, the volume, so between 0 and 100% telegram we can change here the volume of the sound, and we can also acknowledge here all alarms via one-bit information. So for all our maximum 20 alarm messages we have our inputs and outputs. One is, for example, here my message number one. This is my first input. Maybe this comes here from my alarm sensor, intrusion alarm panel, maybe from an analog input to measure the temperature or the pressure or humidity or something. Or here we have a phase failure. Then we get the information from our energy meter, the one-bit information, and trigger here our alarm message. And of course, here the next object to acknowledge the device or to send here the message that the alarm is acknowledged by the end user when he ticks here, when he push here the tick. Good, so far it's not really difficult, yeah, to link here the group addresses. Yeah, very easy. Good, then let's come to the time programs. So totally we can have here 10 time programs, and each time program can have up to 6 switching times, or so-called time slots. So, and now what is here very nice, that the end user creates here his time programs and the time slots. So in the ETS and DCA, you will see the next slides, we enable only the time programs, but we don't link group addresses, we don't create our timers in the ETS. The end user is doing it here, and so he's also very flexible, so he can always create new timers, he can delete timers, he can change the time switches, the time slots, so it's very flexible because everything is done here by the end user. So what else? Okay, what we need, of course, is the time and date. So we need maybe a time master, which sends the time and date via the group objects here to the room touch to synchronize it. But you can set also the time and date in the system menu. This is also possible. So additionally, we have a so-called vacation function. It means such a time program or a time slot can be assigned to a vacation function. So vacation means, depending vacation is now active or not, the time program will be executed or not. It's also possible. Or independent the vacation, so every day, always, sorry, not every day, so always this time program is now triggered. Good, then let's go to the ETS for the commissioning. So again, we go here on the left side in the DCA app of our room touch to the menu applications. And then we have here again our default settings, we have our alarms, and we have here our so-called time programs. So we click on the time programs, yeah, and then we get some parameters. So we set the parameters, and that's all. So when we have a look at the parameters, you will see we have only the main parameter, use time programs, yes, yeah, and then we get only here 3 parameters and the group objects. At first, we can also protect our page for the timers via PIN when we say yes, and then the end user maybe needs here a PIN to enter time programs, which is recommended, for example, in hotels or in office buildings where you have different colleagues, so no one can change your time program without a PIN code. And override time programs at download. So it's very important. Maybe the end user creates all his time programs and the time slots, and then when you tick it here and you make a download, then all former time programs are now overwritten. So be careful, maybe in a real installation, it makes sense to say no, and then after download of the room touch, all time programs are still remain. Good, these are all the parameters, the ETS, no more. So then everything else we do it in the room touch. So we go here on the main menu, go on the left side to the timer. So we tap here on the timer, and depending the parameters, we need a pin or not. So here I come to my page of the timer. Then I see here at the beginning, everything is empty because we have not created time programs. But in this example, you see here there are still some, maybe 1, 2, 3 time programs. So one is, for example, here the training room, one is here dimmer. So this is the name, for example, here for our time programs. And via the button here, you can also activate or deactivate a time program, also possible. Good, how does it work? Or how is the principle of these time programs? This is also similar like we have it, we'll see in the IP touch panel or also in the smart touch panel. So at first, we have here control elements in our room touch, maximum 30. The next step is we select here one of the control element, like for example here, shutter in my meeting room, up and down. And then we create a time program. And the next step is that this time program of my shutter and blinds can consist up to 6 time switching times or time slots. So one is, for example, a switching time from Monday to Friday. So I can edit here and say, okay, you are active from Monday to Friday. And next switching time or time slot is, for example, active Saturday to Sunday. And a next time slot, for example, is active like when I'm on vacation, also possible. So maximum 6 of these different time slots or switching times belong to here our time program. And now when we use this control element shutter of my meeting room for a time function, then you will see we get here additional icon, which shows, oh, this one here is used in a timer program. Without the icon, yeah, it is not used in time program, but this is here information for the end user. So that's what we are doing in the next step. We select here one control element and then we create our time program. Good, let's start. So we are here in our timer view. So we click here on this plus button and then we come to the next page and here we get a list of all control elements. Yeah, maximum we can have 30 control elements. Then we select here control element. Like here, these are, for example, some switch control elements, or here some dimmer sliders, or for RGB control. Yeah, and here this is, for example, this is the a scene for my training room. You see here the icon, it looks like a scene. So I select now here this control element scene and click here on the button of the next page. So then I have selected here now my scene, and now I have to define the function. What should happen when the timer switches on? Should the light goes on, off, up, down, RGB color, purple, or brightness, or should the scene should be called? What should happen? Then I select it here, like for example, as I start my presentation scene, or on, off, up, down, and go to the next page. The next page, I specify all the time parameters. Like here, at first, the starting time. Well, when should this time switch start? At maybe, for example, 3:05. Depending on my control, I can also here set the end time. Like when I use, for example, a standard control element for switching on and off, then it's possible. But when I have a scene, I cannot switch off a scene. A scene is only, I call the scene, and that's all. On which days? I can select here Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday per week. I can also tap here on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Then the time function is from Monday to Wednesday active. Additionally, I can use also here the astro function. This is also possible. But then I have to enter in the general parameters also where is the room touch installed. So the longitude and the latitude. Additionally, I have here the parameters for the vacation function. So I can select here also always, then independent vacation, yes or no. It is also switched every Tuesday. Or I can say here only at vacation or not at vacation. So these are the 3 possibilities I can set here. And such a vacation I can trigger via KNX Telegram, also via another time function. Good, okay, then finished. When I click the button OK, then I have here created my first time program. And remember, I can have here up to 6 time slots. So here, this is my first time slot I have created before. I can say here, for example, call this scene at this time. Here from Monday to Friday, for example, only at vacation, always. and so on. So this is still possible what I can do here in or per of this time switch. Good, now when I go back to my timer, you get here the overview of this maximum 10 time programs. Like for example here, you get more information, like here 6 out of 6. What does it mean? It means that I have here created 6 time slots, and all these 6 time slots are now active. If not, if I say, okay, I want to deactivate this time slot, and then I will see only here 5 out of 6. So what I can also activate or deactivate is a complete time program. So when I deactivate here, then also my maximum 6 included time slots are now deactivated. Good, to edit a time slot, a time program, I click again here, and then I jump again in the same menu like I create a time program. So some words about this vacation function. So the vacation, I can also here trigger the vacation or switch it on and off via a KNX telegram. So I have here one group object, activate vacation, and another one which gives me the status if it's active or not. The end user can also activate the vacation here in the menu vacation.set. So when he click on this button here, tap, and then this page pops up, and here he can activate the vacation from 11th of November to what he wants, only one day, or for example, 1 week or 1 month, what he's setting here at the end of the vacation. It's also possible. So what else? Deleting a time program or time slot. So you click on the program or time slot, and slide it here to the left. And then again, here the rubbish bin pops up and confirm. And then you can delete here also a time slot. Good, so far the time programs. Let's go to some further functions, like for example the favorite control elements. So when we go here to our applications menu, then we have here one maybe submenu which are so-called favorite controls. At the beginning, this folder of course is empty. What I can do is I create for example a template of a control element, like when I have when I need this special control element with really special parameters in a lot of more pages, then I can create a template. And later I can take this template via drag and drop and move it here, for example, into my room. So it's much more easier than I take the control from here and do all the settings again. So now to add such a control to this favorite page, it is not difficult. We go on the navigation page. Then we go to an operating page, like here in my training room or somewhere else. And via drag and drop, we take here, for example, our RGB control element, put it here on the right side, and then we set here all the parameters. Like, for example, this is for warm white, cold white. We set the minimum color temperature, the maximum color temperature, the data point type, and so on. We do all the settings here, and then we click on the right side of our element, and then a window pops up, and here we can click and say add to favorites. The same we can do here when we go down and click on this button, add to favorites. So then a new window pops up, and we can enter here the name, like for example DALI warm white cold white control, and click on the button OK. And then exactly this control with these parameters are now then added here to our favorite, and then later I can go to another page and via drag and drop add it here to my operation view. So a nice feature, for example, here of this favorite controls. What else? The proximity sensor. So when if you want to use it, proximity means when you come closer to the room touch, and the room touch is now switched off, so the display is black, or the screensaver is active, and you come closer, depending on the sensitivity we have set, it is automatically switched on. So or the screensaver is now stopped. So you can activate this proximity sensor when you say yes. We can set the sensitivity between 1 is really close to the device, or 3 is the maximum distance. I have tested here, the maximum distance is about 40 centimeters. So 40 centimeters, So and what else? We can also use here 1-bit output from the proximity sensor, not only the display is now activated and the screensaver stopped. We can also send this information to KNX. So we got here proximity function output, and then we send here the value 1 to trigger, for example, also other functions. So now, when we come closer, we can also set here switch on value. It should be, for example, the value on and For off is also, for example, possible. Good, okay, so far this proximity sensor. Then let's come to the primary function. Primary function means, that's what I showed you at the beginning. You have minimum at least three fingers or all five fingers. Yeah, and here you touch the room touch, and then the so-called primary function is now triggered. Primary function is that the device sends a group address here to the bus. Which kind of object it is also possible to set it as a parameter. It can be a one-bit information, like for example switching on and off, a one byte to call a scene, for example, or also possible to change the operation mode. So this function maybe is used maybe when you enter a room, the room is dark, and you touch here with all your fingers the room touch, you switch on maybe the ceiling light or the basic light, you call a welcome scenario, or for example to call a panic scene or do something else, or when you leave the building, touch with all the fingers and then switch off all the lights. Good, this is so-called primary function. And in the ETS, we click here on the left side to the applications, and then we get here the primary function, we activate the primary function, and then we have the possibility to select here the icon, like we see here, this is our bulb incandescence light with blue, this is exactly what we see later here. So this icon, we can choose here the object type, if it's a one bit, a one byte, a scene, or also the room temperature mode. So then when we select the one bit, then of course we can say reaction on press, value 1, or when we release, for example, value 2. And then he sent the value 1 like an on, or value 2 like an off, also possible. Good, primary function. Then we come to the next one, it's our information starting page. This information starting page will be shown, for example, after the deactivating of the screensaver. So when you come closer, we have the proximity sensor, for example. Then we get here up to 4 lines. And each line can be a fixed static text, or it can be a 14-byte text, which is received via KNX Telegram, or this line is not visible, like for example, no. So let's go to the ETS. If we want to use it, we say information starting page, yes. Then we get here our 4 lines, use line 1, 2, 3, 4. Then we can say, what is line number 1? Show a static text. And then we get here a new parameter, static text line number 1. And then we enter here really a static text, welcome, for example, or something else. And line number 2, we can select here a 14-byte text. And then we get here group object info page line 2 input. And then when we receive here 14-byte text, this text will be then displayed in the line number 2. And the same for line number 3. And line number 4, we say no. And then line number 4 is not visible. So this is a nice feature maybe to get a greeting message when you enter the room, in a meeting room or something. And last but not least, we have our screensaver. The screensaver will start maybe after here our fixed time, like after 5, 10, up to 120 minutes, the last operation. So we have different kind of screensaver modes. It can be, for example, a clock. So we can select here screensaver mode analog or digital clock. So and then we see the time here on the room touch. The next one is we select here a slide show. Then we get some more parameters, like for example, the interval time between two pictures. Should it be pushed from the right side or faded, for example? Or how should the pictures be shown, by random or in alphabetic orders? So this can be also set here. Very important that all these pictures must be on a micro SD card, which remains inserted in the room touch. So if you remove then the SD card, then the slideshow stopped and shows here the standard screensaver mode, the clock. So and all the pictures must be in a folder called photos. So it can be JPEGs, PNGs, bitmaps, and then the screensaver starts with this slideshow after the time we have here. Additionally, the screensaver can be also activated via KNX Telegram. So it's also possible. Like for example, when you leave the room, for example, or not only after this time, 5 minutes, you want to start the screensaver earlier, then via 1B Telegram, we can also trigger it. And the third possibility of screensaver mode is a so-called weather data. Yeah, then the outdoor temperature, the rain, wind speed and brightness will be shown. But this requires, of course, that a room touch receives these values via KNX telegrams. Good, what else? That the end user can also change the screensaver settings in the menu. So when he goes to the system settings, submenu screensaver, then you see again here the same parameters like before in the ETS. So like here, the screensaver starts after 5 minutes. It is a slideshow. It is, for example, our weather data or our clock was, for example. Yeah. And this display switches off after this time. It means after 5 minutes, the screensaver starts with our slideshow. And after 30 minutes, the display is switched off. Here, for example, the parameters, which belongs here to our slideshow, the transitions, and the next picture after 10, 20 seconds. Good, so far, this was my presentation, a bit longer than only 30 minutes, sorry, about the ABB Room Touch with the alarm messages, time programs, the further functions like the primary function or the proximity sensor. Thank you for listening, and I hand back now to Thorsten.
Yeah, super, Jürgen. Another online learning session about this multifunctional ABB Room Touch. I think it's worth to do. And I think we hope at least with our online learning session, especially with this product, you can create all these functions without reading the manual. Yeah, it's really a kind of guidebook also to create all these functions. You see on the picture two other touch panels we have. Remember the ABB IP Touch, also recently launched, similar to the ABB Room Touch, more functions and quantity especially. Also using the DCA concept, and in many functions we have shown in our online learning session around the Room Touch are the same here in the IP Touch. So it's valid also for this product. And down there you see the Bush Smart Touch KNX. It's a product existing already some time, and at the moment to be programmed via normal native ETS application, but will be changed on the next future into this DCA concept. We programmed and also in the inside the ETS via the DCA add-on, and then you have also here again similar functions or the same functions that you have seen in the ABB Room Touch. Not 100% the same, but it's close to this. So more or less for three components than what we have shown you in the last online learning sessions. Allow me to show the final slides as always. So you find everything around the product on our homepage, as you know, for all other products as well. All our training material, also this session will be stored or is stored on our training qualification database, but you get also the link then with a feedback email. In our calendar, we have at the moment more or less only our online trainings, no classroom or presence trainings in the factory at the moment, neither our certified trainings. But we plan for the next year, as usual, our dates with activities in the factories. We will see when and what will be possible. Not known at the moment, but I will inform you accordingly if we know more. Yeah, and what's next for our webinars or online learning session? Next week, we come to a webinar with the topic KNX switch actuators with energy functions. Originally planned already yesterday, but we had to postpone this. So next Wednesday then, 18th of November, and then we talk about the last step, not the last, at this moment the last step in the KNX switch actuator range from ABB, and it's a component called with energy functions. So there is real measurement behind, like in energy meters, and a lot of nice functions we will explain. And as in a webinar, we cannot do everything in a detail or in details, especially regarding programming. Then we continue on Thursday next week with a further online learning session around this topic, switch actuator with energy functions, so to get some more details about how to implement these functions via ETS and so on. Good. I sent you still today the PDF file of this presentation. Then I say thank you for your participation, for your patience, a bit longer than normal, but I think it was worth to listen. Thank you, Jürgen, and hope to see you next time. Ciao, bye.